Okay, we are live. Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV online education webinars. We would like to thank all our faculty for sharing their knowledge and expertise with all, especially in such challenging times. We wish all our audience a healthy and safe days ahead, and we hope these webinars add value to your time. These webinars are dependent on internet speed, which might be at times unstable. Please bear with us for any issues with the internet. All information and academics discussed in the webinar are sourced by the speakers from reliable sources. However, please use the information provided in the webinar only after confirming with standard teaching. The opinions in webinar are for academic purposes only and are not a substitute for evidence. The speakers, neither the portal, is responsible for any untoward events caused due to information presented in the webinar. The topic for today's webinar is knee preservation, and we have speakers with us, Dr. Vivek Dhaiya, Dr. Atik, and Dr. Ranjit Panigrahi. Our moderators will be Dr. Ashok Rajgopal and Dr. David Rajan. Over to you, Dr. Ashok Rajgopal.
Hello, and good evening to all the people who have logged into this Ortho TV webinar. First of all, I wish you all a safe passage through these absolutely crazy COVID times. And we'd like to thank the Ortho TV for facilitating this webinar. So the topic is preservation, the knee preservation, and we have three speakers, and we're going to talk on issues of reconstruction of the knee joint. We have Dr. Ranjit Panigrahi from Bhubaneswar. We have Dr. Atik Vasudev from Medanta Medicity. And we have Dr. Vivek Dhaiya, also from Medanta Medicity. And co-moderating with me is my very old, very dear friend, Dr. David Rajan, who I'm sure all of you know, and he's in Coimbatore. And we started with arthroscopies almost some 30 odd years ago. So without further ado, I'd like to start by asking our first speaker, Dr. Vivek Dhaiya. And he's going to be talking to us on ACL reconstruction, all inside technique. Vivek, all yours.
Thank you. So can you see the slides?
Not yet. Kindly press on share screen, then select PowerPoint. Yeah.
Okay, sorry, I have to do it again.
We can see it now, just do slideshow.
Yeah. So now you can see the screen.
Yes.
All right. So today we are going to speak on the all inside ACL reconstruction, why and how. So treatment of an ACL reconstruction is pretty standardized. If the patient is unstable, you will go in for an arthroscopic ACL reconstruction. We all know that it is a surgery. It might cause some pain. We know that whatever graft we use, either both semitendinosus or the gracilis or the PPT tendon, there will be some graft site morbidity. Sometimes we all of us get with a small graft or an attenuated graft. We all know that I like an 8 millimeter graft. Sometimes when we do not get it, we are a problem. And going forward in the follow-up, whenever the condition of revision happens due to a repeat injury or something, we see a lot of big widening of the tunnels. And lastly, but not the least, the skeletal images do pose a problem because of the open physis. So looking at all these problems, some 20 years ago, people started thinking about the all inside ACL reconstruction, which allowed us to take care of a lot of things. So it allowed us to do an ACL reconstruction without an additional accessory portal. The thickness of the femoral wall could be accurately measured before the drilling. There was no empty space in the femoral canal, so there was less of the windshield wiper effect, so there was less widening of the canals. The best part was that only the semitendinosus tendon is needed. You can do a quadruple. You can suture it with the fiber tape and wire, and which is called the grafting technique, and it can be used with the double suspensory suspension. And also you don't need to break the tibial canal through the cortex. Using the clip cutter, all these things are taken care of. So what all does it lead to? We had two review articles coming in 2017 and 18. So Mr. Connaughton et al. Took into account six studies, which had a total of 370 patients. Three studies used the quadrupoid semitendinosus and three used posterior tibial tendon. Three of them out of the six studies used an autograft, the rest were all allografts. What they found was, so what they did was they used a dual suspensory fixation for all. They found that there were decreased bone removal and a smaller skin incision. The clinical results, when they compared them to standard ACL reconstruction, was similar in all aspects, except there were decreased VAS scores for pain in the inside technique. There was a very higher learning curve for this technique. So they had a 12% graft failure rate in their study. They did not find any tunnel expansion when they followed these patients up to 37 months. And yes, they did not find any growth disturbances in skeletally immature patients. The second review article was published by Disha in the Journal of Knee Surgery in 2018. They were able to compare 13 studies with 526 patients. The mean follow-up was from 18 to 25 months. Again, 73% were about autografts and 26% were allografts. They had a total of 31 complications, which included 2.4% of graft failure and of 1% loss of extension from 1 to 10 degrees. So this is why we need to think about an all-inside ACL reconstruction. How do we do it? So we need some specialized equipment, especially the flip cutter. And mainly the two things, two tunnels have to be drilled. The femoral tunnel can be drilled by the inside out or the outside in technique. Those of us familiar in using the anteromedial technique of drilling the femoral condyle tunnel are pretty much comfortable using the inside out, but it also needs a lot of knee flexion, hyperflexion actually, and sometimes we damage the medial femoral condyle. So for our ease, Arthrex came out with an outside in drive, and I'll show you a small video which is taken by the from the Arthrex website to show us how are we going to. How do we do it? So after marking the insertion site on the femoral condyle, we are using the outside in guide. We take in the flip cutter, pierce the cortex inside, and then deploy the pincer. And since we all already know how much we need to drill, we don't have to be measuring it. So we should ideally try to be 25 millimeters long. And a similar, we pass the suture, which comes out through the anteromedial portal. Similarly, the tibial tunnel is also drilled using the flip cutter. And the prepared graft is first passed through the femoral condyle through the anteromedial portal. Once the button flips, we are able to tighten the cord so that the graft sits well into the socket. And then we pull the suture out through the tibial tunnel and we seat the button on the tibial surface. We must ensure that the tensioning of the suture should be done on both sides at least twice to make sure that the graft is well sitting and it causes no loosening. We must make sure that we are carefully preparing the quadrupoid semitendinous graft because our fiber wire is going to hold the graft in place. And if the construct is not stable enough or strong enough, we are going to have a premature loosening or breakage of the graft. Then we need to look at the graft length, which should be around 79-80 millimeters long, so that we don't end up with a short graft. Adequate pre-tensioning is very important because we know when we are using adjustable loops or hamstring tendon grafts, about 3 millimeters of deadening can happen. We need to have a proper tunnel fixing, and double tightening of the loop should always be done on both sides so that the graph sits well into the sockets. This is a tough thing to learn. It has its own learning curve. Now, the controversy is what we need to look into it is, does it allow us to provide early rehab? So all of us have developed our own protocols, but the question is still under debate on how early or how aggressive rehab can be done. The third question is that, is dual suspensory fixation enough? Because Lubovitz in a number of studies has told us and shown that even an aperture fixation can be used for this. We do not know. And whether the adjustable loop or the fixed loop is better for this on the tibial side. So this in short is what an all-inside ACL reconstruction looks after the surgery. It helps us with reduced pain, less graft site mobility, helps us with decreased, it prevents flexion, prevents loss of flexion strength in the hamstrings. So that's why it's a good thing to use. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Vivek. That was an elegant presentation of the all-inside ACL reconstruction. May I now request Ranjit? He's going to talk to us about internal bracing for the MCL. So, Ranjit, can you take over and give us your presentation now?
Dr. Ranjit, you are muted. Can you unmute yourself?
Yeah, it's okay.
Now we can hear you. Yes.
Yeah. Thanks, Dr. Rajgopal sir and Dr. David sir for giving me the opportunity, and Dr. Atik for the help. And shall I start now?
Yeah, please do. Yeah, please start.
Okay. Now it's visible?
Yes.
So my talk is on MCL repair with internal bracing. Now it's a noble technique and it's a new technique, and all of us should know about this technique. No, it's not moving actually. Okay. Now medial collateral ligament is commonly injured along with the anterocruciate ligament. The literature says it's 20 to 38%. MCL has better healing capacity that we all know, and which has led all of us to perceive that MCL tears can be treated conservatively, whereas ACL tears requires operative treatment. Now, coming to the anatomy, the MCL has two parts, superficial MCL and deep MCL. Superficial MCL is attached on the femoral side, just proximal and posterior to the medial femoral epicondyle. And on the tibial side, it's attached 12.2 millimeter distal to the tibial joint line, and again 6 centimeter roughly, 61.2 millimeter distal to the tibial joint line. Now the MCL has superficial MCL, the fibers, the anterior fibers are tight in flexion and extension, and posterior fibers are tight in full extension, and both of them are lax at 30 degree of flexion. And it provides principal stability to valgus and external rotation stress. Now, deep MCL has two components, meniscofemoral component and meniscotibial component, and it acts as secondary restraint to the valgus stress. And the meniscotibial ligament, particularly, it provides rotational stability of the knee, and along with the posterior horn of the medial meniscus, it provides the stability. POL. Initially, it was considered as the poster person of superficial MCL, but Huxton and et al., they later described it as a part of it's a separate ligament. Now it has three parts, superficial part, central part, and capsular part. And central part is very important, which is attached to the femur, 7.7 millimeter distal and 2.9 millimeter to the gastrocnemius tubercle. Now it is an internal rotation resistant ligament. Now different biomechanical studies have come up, and they have seen that sectioning the superficial MCL and POL almost increases all the mobility of the knee, like internal rotation, external rotation, anterior and posterior translation. and sectioning the MCL or any kind of MCL injury, they indirectly or directly increase the load on ACL, as evidenced by these two studies on Journal of Knee Surgery and by Battaglia et al. In American Journal of Sports Medicine. Now, MCL injuries has been classified by Houston et al. Into three grades, grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, where grade 1 has localized tenderness, grade 2 tenderness with partial instability, grade 3 complete instability, 1 plus is 3 to 5 millimeter laxity, 2 plus is 6 to 10 millimeter laxity, and 3 plus is more than 10 millimeter laxity. Now, fetal-marcel classification of the MCL is very important because it classifies the MCL injury and it leads us to the line of treatment. So grade 1 is without any valgus laxity, both at 0 degree and 30 degree of flexion. Grade 2, valgus laxity at 30 degree of flexion, but stable in 0 degree flexion. And grade 3, valgus laxity, both at 0 and 30 degree of flexion. So all should give emphasis on performing this test at 0 degree of extension so that you can know what kind of treatment you are going to plan. Diagnosis of MCL injury or know about the history, clinical features, tests, and investigations like X-ray, and MR.
Dr. Ranjit, we cannot hear you.
First, so the main statement, regardless of
Ranjit, we can't hear you. You are breaking up.
Can you hear me? Hello.
Ranjit, your video is unstable. I think internet is unstable.
Unstable.
You have to share your screen again. Your
just
screen.
Try again. Share it again.
Okay. I close it and again say.
Yeah, and just try and keep your mic a little away from your mouth because,
Okay.
Yeah, now we can hear you. You can just share your screen now.
It's visible now.
We can see you. We can't see your content.
Yeah, we can see the screen.
Yeah, that's good.
Just go three,
yeah,
four
that's
slides.
Fine. That's fine.
Three, four slides before this.
Okay. This one?
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. You can start from here.
Okay. So, fetal and marcel classification is the most important classification for MCL injury. So, fetal and marcel classified MCL injury into three types, grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3. Grade 1, there is no valgus laxity both at 0 and 30 degree of flexion. Grade 2, valgus laxity is at 30 degree of flexion but stable in 0 degree of flexion. And grade 3, we can get valgus laxity in both 0 degree and 30 degree of flexion. So this classification is very important as far as treatment part is concerned. So one should give emphasis on performing the test in 0 degree of extension always. All of us know about the diagnosis of MCL injury from the history and clinical feature, the special tests and the investigation modalities, X-ray in chronic cases, stress X-ray and MRI. So conservative treatment is the key modality of MCL management. So mainstay of treatment, regardless of severity, except patients with instability at 0 degree of flexion, we usually manage them conservatively. And off late, we go a little aggressively in our conservative treatment. We apply hinge knee brace and we allow early knee movement. And we encourage isometric exercises and crutches are discontinued when the patient can walk without limping. Operative indications for acute repair and delayed repair, we all know. And the different procedures of repair and the repair with augmentation and advancement surgeries, we know. And we do reconstruction in delayed chronic valgus laxity. So the current MCL management strategy, now putting the patient on immobilization for a longer period, it leads to stiffness and wasting. and it leads to residual MCL laxity, which predisposes to loss of ACL graft tension and rupture. It leads to recurrent instability leading to OA, and failed treatment, we all know, is always expensive. The different operative indication as of now is isolated acute grade 3 MCL or POL injuries, where we can get the avulsion of tibia stenar lesion and the knee opens grossly at 0 and 30 degree. There is increased external rotation and we are getting any meniscal root tear or drive-through sign positive, we should go for operative view. And significant laxity in case of hyperlax individuals and obesity, as well as high demand athletes, they do require operative intervention. Acute grade 3 MCL injury with combined ligament injuries almost always require operative intervention nowadays. And in chronic scenarios, we can go with MCL reconstruction by Laparotte technique, and simultaneously we should correct the alignment if any issue. So when we are discussing about the MCL operative intervention, now internal brace is a very good tool and it's a novel technique to use. Internal brace technique uses a high strength suture tie to augment injured tissue or a primary repair, allowing early rehabilitation. This MCL internal brace consists of 2 millimeter wide fiber tape that spans the distance between two knotless swivel lock anchors in order to provide a protective reinforcement of primary MCL repair that exceeds the strength of the native ligament. So the good biomechanical study by Gilmer et al., which states that the mean movement to failure and valgus angle at failure is greater for internal bracing than for repair, though it is almost similar to reconstruction. So internal bracing has its role. So what are the advantages of internal bracing? It bridges the injured area, it reestablishes the normal length, it allows healing, the minimal soft tissue interface or
we can't hear you again. You're breaking up.
Near humeral condyle, proximal and posterior to, and the distal part 3.3 to 5 centimeter distal to the.
He is disconnected, I think.
So, Ranjit, we're not able to hear you at all. Is he disconnected?
He's disconnected. He's frozen. The video is frozen.
Okay. In the interest of time, maybe we can go back to this presentation later. Can I request Atik? Can you come on and speak about the all inside PCL technique? I know you're very passionate about this and you've written up about this article as well. So let's have you presenting your thing, and hopefully by then we can get Ranjit to log in and complete his presentation. So Atik, can you do it?
So Ranjit will, I think, have to unshare his screen before I can start.
Now you can do it.
Can you see my screen?
Yeah. Now we can hear. Yeah.
Okay. I thank both Dr. Rajgopal and Dr. Rajan for having me here. And Dr. Rajgopal rightly said, I am pretty passionate about the PCL.
So hello. Hello.
Yeah, Ranjit is, I think, back online.
So Ranjit, we will take your remaining presentation at the end. Dr. Yeah. Present now.
Okay, sorry for the these things, because the internet, I think, is really no worries.
We'll finish your presentation. We're just starting with Atik. So as soon as that finishes, you can get ready and then we'll do it. Atik, you want to go on, please?
Okay. Yes. Okay. So I'm going to speak about the All Inside ACL risk reconstruction, when and how. Basically, it's a technique which we've done together in 2016. It's a little different. I'll tell you how. Also, I'll request both the chairmen to give me a little extra time, because I'm going to talk about the difficulties also which I have faced in doing.
No, absolutely. Inside. Please go ahead, Atik. I think it's important that you talk through the journey.
So we all know about epidemiology and the function of the PCL, and we know that the primary function is basically a prevention of posterior tibial translation when the knee goes from extension to flexion between 30 and 90 degrees, which is quite evident here when you look at the x-ray where the PCL is gone and you give a backward push and you get this x-ray taken. And you also know that these injuries are not as common as the ACL, but they may be as common as 44% and going up to 95% in high velocity injuries as road traffic accidents. But also we must understand that we need to understand the incidents. And if you look at this article, which came out very recently in 2016, you can see that the incidence of meniscal tears was 2 times, symptomatic arthritis 6 times, and the patients eventually going in for a total knee replacement 3 times without when they had PCL injuries compared to patients who did not have. I think this is a very important statistic. I think before we speak about anything about the PCL reconstruction, we need to know a little bit about the anatomy. And we all know that it has 2 large bundles. And I think this is a beautiful article by the Laprade group, where he says that you have a large bundle, the anterolateral bundle, and a smaller posterior medial bundle. And he pointed out the trochlear point and the mid-arch point, which makes it easier for us to reconstruct. Most of us do the single bundle technique. That means we are actually reconstructing the anterolateral bundle. So it would be safe to say that you could go about 8 millimeters down and behind the trochlear point. Also, what we need to understand is there are certain ligaments present, which are almost there in 93% of patients, where at least one is present, and these originate from the lateral meniscus. These are the anterior ligament of Humphrey and the posterior of Risberg. Though we do not exactly know that what is their function today, but Nagasaki, in his presentation in the American Journal of Sports Medicine in 2006, said that these did provide some amount of resistance to posterior stress in 90 degrees of flexion, but it's not been proven so far. Now, if you look at these beautiful pictures which came out by the Cato and the Smigleski group, I have taken permission from them to reproduce this. I must mention that. And if you look at, I'll just show you, if you look at where the PCL, let me just get the pointer option. If you look at where the PCL is, now this is not the PCL. This is actually the ligament of Humphrey. Whereas this is where the PCL is. Now, if all of us who do total knee replacements, you can see that this is the white side line, and you can see it's almost parallel to that. So we have to be very careful about this. We should not end up reconstructing this line. A lot of times when we begin, this is where we end up, and this is not where we should be doing that. If we are doing the single bundle, we should be somewhere here. And if you want, you can go and read this article by Cato and Smigleski. It came out in the KSCA in 2017, and he also mentioned that these were not 2 bundles, but a flat structure which rolled over like a piece of paper and gave an impression of a double bundle. Coming to the tibial attachment, we all know that it's attached at the PCL facet, way below, and it's about 1.5 centimeters below to the posterior rim of the tibia. Now, if you look at this, it's a complete reflection of what's attached to the femur. If you look at the anterolateral bundle, which is huge, it almost occupies 60 to 70% of the attachment in the femur. It's exactly the opposite in that in the tibia. It's also important for us to know how to make our tunnels, because if we make it there, we probably end up damaging the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. And of course, this is most important. We should know the artery, where the artery goes, because quite often all of us who've done PCL have once in a, at least damaged it. Now, factors that are important for PCL reconstructions are timing. These all are actually almost taken care of. PCL remnant or preservation or excision. We can do both graft selection. We're almost there now, single or double bundle. A lot of debate, but eventually a lot of papers saying the results are almost the same. It's your fixation, what you want to do it. Different types of fixation methods. And of course, today we talk about the technique. popular technique includes the tibial tunnel technique, which everybody knows about, and the tibial inlay technique. Then why do we need to talk about the all inside technique? It's because this huge amount of papers which started coming out in recent years about all inside ACL reconstruction with very good results over time using different types of grafts. So when you look at that, these results were all excellent and very predictable. And these are papers which coming out as early as this year and been going on for a couple of years now. So when we look at that, and again, we had papers coming with very good results of all inside posterior cruciate ligament reconstruction in 2019 and 2020, saying the results are very, very good. So when we look at that, when we look at the aims of the all inside, we need to minimize surgical trauma, which could eventually have good clinical outcomes. We need to improve tendon bone healing, decrease pain and morbidity, hasten recovery and return to activities with better stability and overall knee function. At the same time, it should be more cosmetically attractive. Now, when we look at all this, then we want our PCL to be successful. So we should have all these benefits of the all inside. It should be safe and reproducible. And I think for me, the most important point is that it should overcome the killer turn. I'm sorry. Can you see my screen? Hello? Can anyone hear me? Hello?
We can hear you.
Okay.
Please carry on. Just keep the mic near your mouth. You're fading off. Yeah.
Okay.
So
now how was it possible? It was basically possible by the availability of different suspensory loop devices like the ACL tightrope or the ultra button, or the other systems available. Also the retrograde drill cutters like the TrueNav and the flip cutters. And of course, the most important thing was the creation of the graft link by Adler. The main change for conventional was basically creation of sockets in place of complete tunnels. And we needed to create this because essentially what was happening was that we were going from aperture fixation to suspensory fixation. So this was the main change which happened. And if you were to look at this paper, which came out in arthroscopy in 2016, they very clearly said bone to tendon healing was far superior when you did a suspensory fixation compared to aperture fixations. Now, what was the advantage of sockets? We preserved the medial cortices. Devices, we did not need to go out. Only one cortex was done. When we did anterograde reaming, especially for PCL, the guide wire did not displace, I think, which was very important. And of course, the strength of fixation was better in the tibia, and it was possible probably to use it in osteoporotic patients because of them lying around. Now, if you look at these blind sockets, probably these provide better biological environment for predictable tendon to bone healing. By excluding the extraneous environments and not allowing release of growth factors, I think this was an important point to be noted, because once growth factors is not gone, we were able to probably heal them better. I think I'll come to my video now, which is all inside PCL reconstruction, which we do. May I just tell you here that this is not the routine all inside PCL that we do. Here we pass the grafts from the posterior medial side. Most of the all-inside PCLs, which have been already described, are from the anterior side. I think the distinct advantage of these were that we were able to totally overcome the killer turn, and because the graft went into a V shape straight into the tibia and into the femur, so there was no question of a killer turn over there. Also, it prevented crowding from trying to pass the graft from the anterior side. So I'll just show a quick video now. So this is you can see my jig, the tibial jig way back. So I usually get into a 90, I use a 70 degrees after seeing it from a 30 degrees. I do not use the posterior medial or the posterior lateral portal. So we use a flip cutter. You can see that we've already drilled our tunnel. We pass a fiber stick and we take out a shuttle from the posterior medial portal. This is a shuttle which has come out of the posterior medial portal. You can see on the inner picture, lower picture, that it's taken out. Of course, then we are making a inside-out tunnel here. Like I said, you can make an inside-out or outside-in. That's up to you. I'll tell you the advantages and disadvantages later. And you pass your, you can see a shuttle happening here once you made the tunnel. Now you take your suture retriever and pass it into the back of the knee. And again, from the posterior medial side portal, you take out the shuttle. So now you have two shuttles from the posterior medial side into from the posterior medial portal. One is from the femur and one is from the tibia. This was a live surgery, one of my live surgical demonstrations. You can see that, that's the femoral tunnel. Pulling the graft into the femur tunnel, you can see that the button is going in. I prefer using a adjustable loop, it just makes it easier. And we have the graft being pulled into the, you can see that the graft has been pulled in. And then we just pull the graft into the tibia. You can see that. And because we are doing a single bundle, that's the anterolateral bundle. We can tighten it over a concave button and we can give an anterior draws in 90 degrees of flexion and tighten it. You can see that. So this is another one of my videos. I'll just hasten it. This is an all inside ACL reconstruction with remnant preservation. So we make a posterior medial bundle. You can so a posterior medial portal. I'll try and hasten it. See if I can go forward. So I've used just to show that you can use an RF also here, in the, again through a 70 degree scope, you can see that. That's a jig through seen through a 70 degree scope, the tibial jig. So I use a curette. I have a curette which I pass through my posterior medial portal. And you can see that instead of using a fiber stick, I've used the beath pin here with the reverse part and pulled out a shuttle through that. And you can see here, we are going way high. You can see it's high, high, high. You have to go very high. Please remember that. Again, the same step. We take the shuttle into the posterior aspect of the knee from the femoral side. And we can pull the graft in. So you can see, actually you can feel the button flipping. So graft going in and you can see the final tensioning. And you can see that the remnant at the end of the surgery. So remnant which has been maintained. So so just to make it simpler to see what we have done is, so what we've done basically is we've taken a shuttle out. Step one is taking a shuttle out of the tibia. And I think the important thing here, what I was talking about when I spoke about anatomy, is about the radiological landmarks. So if you look at the tibia in the posterior aspect, the anterior lateral bundle is higher and the posterior medial bundle is lower. So what you need to do is you need to go into the between or slightly below the anterior lateral bundle. If you go into the anterior lateral bundle, as a tendency is, we will definitely end up damaging the posterior horn of the medial meniscus, which is not a good thing to happen. And of course, I think if you look at this, in arthroscopy in 2016, they made it very clear that you do not depend on the fovea at all. Instead, you must not give up the C-arm. There was an editorial also in this. If you look at the middle picture, that's the B picture, that is the correct position of the tibia to look at. You cannot have it in A, which is internal rotation, and B, which is an external rotation, because you'll get a false orientation. So the second step is that you take out you've taken it out from the tibia one. The second step is to take it out from the femur. So I prefer using an inside-out technique. You can use an outside-in technique, but there's even enough evidence to say that either technique is same, but the graft angles are gentler when you use the inside-out technique, and also you don't end up damaging the vastus medialis sometimes, which may happen when you do an outside-in technique. Then what also I do is I lengthen out my adjustable loop so that I pass, as you saw, I pass the loop, the button first, and then pulled my graft in. If your loops are short, you can have a problem because the graft may not go in so easily then. So step four is that you pass it into the tibia. And then you pull it out. So I think these are important steps. These are basically five steps in which you do the surgery. Now, what are the advantages of doing this? The advantages are that when you use sockets, you're basically using incomplete tunnels, so bone sparing. I think this is of great relevance when you are doing multi-ligament surgeries, and it can prevent, also it can give you enough bone stock and also prevent tunnel convergence. Tunnel widening is less, as I will show you. It's possible in open physis. Only thing that you have to be careful about while doing the PCL is the femur is never a challenge because you're going into the physis. But you have to be careful when you're doing in children is that you have to go way below and you cannot go to the standard site because your regular jigs are not going to sit easily in a child. You have to go below and the graft acts like a sling. Lubovitz in 2015 said the pain was reduced and allografts are normally not required. So this is one of my own x-rays. I'm afraid it's of the ACL. You can see that this is a 4.5-year-old x-ray, and you can see I've used a suspensory device and there is no tunnel widening over here. And also you have the advantage of secondary tensioning, as you can see in this video. So you can see that once you have done cycled your knee and everything and you feel it's final and there's a little thing. So this is an ACL. So you can see that there is some amount you can do a secondary tensioning over here. Of course, there are certain limitations like in every surgery. Your graft length is critical. Either you can bottom out. Posterior medial portals cannot be used for visualization of graft passage. A smaller tendinosus, semitendinosus may only allow triplication. Of course, the major advantage of a technique is that it overcomes the killer turn by passing the graft directly into the sockets. And I'd like to show you now some of my post-operative x-rays in various situations where I use it. This is a straightforward all-inside PCL. This is an all-inside PCL and an all-inside ACL. These are immediate post-op x-rays. And of course, this is an all-inside PCL with a standard ACL. So you can use it in any situation. Another interesting situation is this was a patient with a fracture, proximal tibia fracture, with an MCL injury and a PCL injury. So first I fixed the fracture and reconstructed the MCL. And then in a second stage, 6 months later, I did the all inside PCL. Now I think what's important is that we need to understand that the problems that I encountered, it's very easy to say that do an all inside, but these are problems which I have encountered and I like to bring it forward. Now these are relevant to all inside techniques, be it the ACL or the PCL. So we'll go through one by one. So I think the most important is that not cutting out when you're tensioning the graft. I think that's very, very important. And there are certain, so when I found this, there was a problem which I was facing. So I went through literature and I found that bigger sutures, that means when you're making the graft, you should use a number two suture, which has got a better pullout strength. And you should bury the knot. like you can see in this video over here. So when you tie the, when you're quadrupling the graph, you tie this over here, and then you use the same, go through that. And also this was another article which where clearly said that this technique has the highest load to failure. So this is what I have been following, and I have found that the results are much better now. Also, the problem I had found was when sometimes when your assistant is trying to pull the button, he pulls it all the way out of the skin, be it medial or lateral side. So I think this is a neat little trick which was published by Dhananjay in arthroscopy techniques, in where you can use the cannula of the arthroscope. You can use that. It's a 4.5 mm. You can easily slip it inside and you can do that. But the important thing is that you must check it. Now, other problems that I have noticed is a medial wall blowout. Now, you can either use a tightrope extender button, which increases the footprint almost by 20 millimeters by 5 millimeters. You can use a concave button, or you can keep a suture disc. A simple suture disc is also sometimes very helpful. Another problems I have encountered is short graft. So you should not get scared if you have a short graft, because the Japanese have very clearly shown that just 10 millimeters of graft inside the tunnel is enough. And I'm one of the strict followers that it's not the tunnel which matters. It's the face where you attach the graft where the real healing occurs. So I'm a great follower of that. And of course, the Japs have always proven us right. The other problems that I've offered is that I was not able to pass the graft. So this can be because of two reasons. One, because of graft socket mismatch. If there's a graft socket mismatch, that means your graft is big and the socket is small. Well, you just have to take it out and you have to make it into a regular PCL or an ACL. And you do that and you'll get away with it. Or the second thing which can happen is that your sutures are entangling. So initially when you are doing that, you probably are not using either a cannula or something like a passport cannula. Or if you are doing that, the best way to do that is to put your suture retriever on one of these and shuttle it, railroad it right through, and watch it with your arthroscope. You'll see it going, and if it's entangling, you can see the sutures entangling there. So it's very easy. Just railroad your suture retriever over it and it'll just become easy for you to do it. Other problems are the bottoming of the graft. As you can see in this picture, this is not a good thing to happen. If this happens, you need to take out your graft. And a good way to start is never use two adjustable loops on both sides with buttons. On the tibia side, it's always better to use a one without the button, like the ABS, because you can pull it out easily and you can complete your tunnel. You rather give the patient a good result than have your ego being satisfied because of not being able to go an all inside. Another thing that we have to understand is we have to understand the implant that we're using. In any surgery, that's very important. So the important thing is when you're using an ABS tightrope, that is a buttonless tightrope, you do not pull it from the strings. You always pull it from where the loop is, because then it will not tighten. And that's how it is. I think the biggest problem is what happens is when we have a problem or breakage of the retrograde drill. This is one of my own patients where I was doing the surgery and the flip cutter broke. These things can happen to any one of us. Don't get scared. If your flip cutter breaks, you can get away with it. If it doesn't flip back, take an artery or take a pituitary. I'm very grateful to Dr. Rajgopal because he's made me add a pituitary into my armamentarium. Or if it breaks, you can just pull it out and you can come out of it. Do not get scared. Do not panic. You can come out and either use another one, or you can create a full drill. It's as easy as that. And this is a publication which you can see, which we published sometime back in 2016, and we have been using this technique ever since. I thank you for your attention.
All right.
Thank you, Atik. That was a very, very elegant presentation. If Ranjit, you're up and ready, maybe you can just complete your, I think you have a few more slides to get through. So if you can through those, we can hopefully, you know, wind up in the next 5-10 minutes, and then we can open up for discussion. So,
okay, sure, sir. So shall I start from the surgical technique directly?
So just slide? Yeah, just start from the point that you left off so that you can continue and just complete your presentation, Ranjit. That'll be nice.
My presentation is visible now?
No, it's not.
Okay, my answer. Now it's visible?
Yeah, now it is.
Okay, so we will start from the surgical technique itself. Now in the MCL reconstruction, the surgical technique, the incision is a mini open or a minimal invasive technique where you will give a small incision over the femur and small incision in the tibia. Instead, you can give a big incision also. There is no issue at all. So on the femoral side, we know that the femoral side, the isometric point is just behind and proximal to the medial femoral epicondyle. So give an incision over the medial femoral epicondyle and then the second incision on the tibial attachment of the MCL attachment, that is, it is proximal to the pes anserine, and 3 millimeter anterior to the posteromedial crest of the tibia, 3 to 5 centimeter distal to the joint line. Now the instrument set which is required for this technique is by Arthrex. It's a 2.4 millimeter guide pin, 4.5 millimeter reamer, 4.7 millimeter tap, and 4.7 millimeter bioswivel lock with fiber tape. So we require 2 swivel lock with 1 fiber tape for this. So we can see a nice demo video from the Arthrex initially, then we will go for the live. So in this demo video,
minimally invasive,
you can see that after giving a small incision on the femur, the 2.4 millimeter bit pin is passed through the point on the femur, just proximal and posterior to the medial femoral epicondyle. Then with 4.5 mm reamer, we can drill up to 25 millimeter. And then we can put the tap in. And then the 4.75 millimeter swivel lock with the fiber top loaded. So once you pass and tighten the swivel lock, you can pull the fiber tap and see the security. Then similarly on the tibial side, 2.4 mm pin. And then you retrieve the fiber tape just below the layer one onto the tibial side and see the isometry. If you see by doing the ROM exercise movements that the isometry is okay, then you drill the tibial side with 4.5 mm reamer and then tap it and pass the fiber tape through the swivel lock and keep a hemostat just underneath the MCL so that it will not be over tightened. Take the knee to 20 to 30 degree of flexion, give a varus force, and in neutral rotation you tighten the swivel lock. Now coming to the real time, you give the incision on the femoral side, a small incision. Now you can repair the MCL if you are having any with the suture anchor or sutures at this point of time. And then you identify the femoral side, femoral point that is just behind and proximal to the medial femoral epicondyle. And then we pass the bit pin. And then on the tibial side, we mark the point and give the incision, and then we pass the pin. After putting the two pins, then we check for the isometry. So at this point, if your isometry is not correct, then you can switch the position of your pin. And once you are satisfied that the isometry is okay, then you start drilling the proximal side and then put the tap and then put the swivel lock loaded with the fiber tape on the femoral side. you do the same thing, pass the drill, then on the tibial side, you load it, tibial side, the same principle varus board and pursue the log.
Ranjit, we are not able to hear you at all.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah, we are not able to hear you at all.
Hello.
Ranjit, we are not able to hear or see you or your presentation.
Okay. Now it's okay, sir?
No, we have a blank.
Hello.
No, we can't see anything. If I can just request you, Ranjit, if you can just summarize your presentation now, and then you can answer some questions during the discussion.
Now it's visible, sir.
We can see you, not your presentation. So if you can just summarize your talk, and then we can pick up some questions during the question and answer. That'd be fine.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, so if you can do your wrap up now, that'd be nice. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So this was the picture before, where we are seeing the drive through sign and the MCL deficiency. And this was the picture after the reconstruction of the MCL, where you can see the drive through sign is completely gone. So this is the post op picture, and this is the clinical picture after 3 months. So you can go with the open technique if you are not comfortable with mini open technique. And the post-op rehab is to obtain early range of movement and to prevent the stiffness and to normalize the gait. You can use brace for 4 weeks along with the weight bearing as tolerated. Brace locked in extension till quadriceps control is regained. Range of movement exercises is started very fast within first few days in a controlled fashion. By 4 to 6 weeks, we start the strengthening exercises and return to sports by 9 months. So what you do in chronic tears, what to do? The Leppard and Ansbersten has nicely demonstrated the technique by anatomical reconstruction of SMCL and POL with 4 tunnels and 2 grafts. And splitting the semity, we can have the 2 grafts, and MCL is tensioned at 30 degree of flexion and POL is tensioned at 0 degree of flexion. Lubovich et al., again, he took this internal bracing principle to again reconstruct the SMCL and POL and got a very good result. So the pulse for the surgeries are use MRI to identify the MCL tear location and other concomitant medial side injuries, identify the avulsed MCL and other injured ligaments simultaneously, repair the avulsed MCL from distal to proximal or proximal to distal. Sufficiently tension the repair stitches before deploying the suture anchor. Load the suture anchor with additional sutures if other ligaments are injured to repair them. And use a large clamp to follow the MCL proximally from distal insertion. Sufficiently tension the fiber tab with the knee at 30 degree of flexion before deploying the anchor. And cycle the knee and fix the fiber tap distally at 30 degree of flexion. So the advantages of internal bracing are it bridges the injured area, re-establishes the normal length, allow healing, allow early movement, and minimal soft tissue interface or dissection is required. So to conclude, it's a well-established track record in the literature that the internal bracing has proved for his results. It eliminates the need to rehab MCL prior to ACL reconstruction, engineered to brace the MCL at the site of injury. It's minimally invasive, low morbidity, and affords excellent medial stability in a multi-ligament knee also. Thank you.
Thank you, Ranjit. That was an excellent presentation. David, do you want to come in and start?
Yes, sure. Excellent presentation from Vivek and Atik. and they conveyed the message of all inside technique for ACL PCL reconstruction. They sound good and very promising. I'm sure there are a lot of questions. And Ranjit, unfortunately, there was some interruption.
Thank you, Ranjit.
But, however, we will discuss.
People come in and.
Yes, sure. Presentation from Vivek and Adik. They conveyed the message of all inside technique for ACL PCL reconstruction. They sound good and very promising. I'm sure there are a lot of questions. And Ranjit, unfortunately, the interruption. However, we will discuss.
Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hello, if I can start.
Mukesh, we are getting a
echo.
Echo of So Mukesh, can you cut off the echo, please? We are getting a rerun of David's comments, please. Okay, so
now it should not be there. Just have a look. Just see.
Yeah, it's okay. Vivek, let me start off by asking you. This all inside is is obviously a very, very elegant technique. What are the distinct advantages apart from the pain part that you mentioned? What are the other advantages that you see, you know, compared to ACL injury?
It's okay. Vivek, let me start off by asking you.
Mukesh, I think we're getting an echo. We are having a repeat of all the questions that we're asking.
Sir, the reason is that somebody has put on Ortho TV link on their side. Have you, Dr. Vivek, have you clicked the Ortho TV link? Is it on in the background?
Well, I would encourage if you have any questions to sort of put that up, and you can sort of WhatsApp it or send it on to Ortho TV, and we'll try and answer those. So, Vivek, what is the advantage of the all inside as compared to the antromedial conventional technique? I mean, in terms of outcomes, what does the literature say? Is there a distinct advantage doing this?
Up till now, all the meta-analysis which have compared almost 13 publications, other than the pain, we have not found much of an advantage. So we are conserving bone. We are reducing the amount of pain the patient is facing. So these are the two major advantages that we have.
Okay, so those are largely sort of subjective in terms of bone conservation and pain, but in terms of long-term outcomes, details, stability, regaining sort of function and get returned to sports.
Yeah, there is almost the same. Okay. Almost the same.
Right. Is there any incidents, anything reported? Obviously, from the way that you have described the technique, the chances of this bungee effect and canal widening obviously are minimized.
Yes.
Are there any reports in literature with the all inside technique which demonstrates that there has been some reports of this? Because that's one of the...
They have not reported any widening of the canal, but they have reported implant failures, especially where the thread joins the button.
Okay.
So that they have reported. And they have reported re-rupture of the graft, but not tunnel widening.
Right. And obviously this has its distinct advantages in terms of a skeletally immature individual. It is a lot of... Clearly, I mean, this would be specifically indicated for patients who are skeletally immature where the epiphyses are open. David, anything you want to ask or any comments or from Atik or Ranjit on the ACL?
Yeah, Yeah, a couple of technical questions. One, do you ream the socket the same size or slightly larger, especially for PCL? And secondly, can any other graft be used for this technique? Say, cordyceps tendon with bone, yeah. Without bone?
I'll take that. Initially, when I started doing this technique, I used to
Atik, use... just hold the mic close to your mouth. We can hear you.
Sorry. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, it's better.
Okay. Initially, when I started doing this technique, I used to use a 0.5 reamer bigger than what I was using because I think it was my apprehension. Now, over time, after I started lengthening the loops and I was able to pull it because it gives me some amount of strength to pull it, to pull the graft inside. So now I use the same tunnel as that of the socket as that of the size of the graft. And what was the second question, sir?
Any other graft can be used.
Yes, I as I mentioned in my slide, you saw that you can use any graft that you want. I have used it with the peroneus longus. Of course, starting with semi-T, peroneus longus, and I've used the CQT also. I use the CQT normally without the bony part. So I can, there is a methodology to connect your adjustable loops to the CQT. Without, you can, if you want, you can do it with bones because you have adjustable loops available now and which can go through bone also. The last thing what I'd like to say is that initially there was a lot of apprehension about doing bone patella tendon using this technique. But now because we have adjustable loops available, the main reason why they said was because the length was not enough in the bone patella tendon to go through from the femur into the tibia. Now because we have adjustable loops which are available, you can actually use the patellar tendon also to do this technique. But my only advice to do that is because it's a little rigid and less negotiable, you would probably want to use a little bigger tunnel, maybe a 0.5 bigger tunnel to facilitate your passage of graft. So any of the grafts can be used to doing this technique.
It's definitely advantageous when you have a short graft.
So the Japanese in their study very clearly showed that it's one, it's the face of the graft where it touches, where, which is important for healing, as you all know. And also they said 10, though I'm a bit skeptical about that. I like to keep, if I have a short graft, I'm okay with 15 millimeters. But they said even 10 was enough for healing. So it's no problem about having a short graft also over here.
Yeah.
And also if you are scared about getting a short graft, the other thing I would mention is with the technique I showed about improving your stitching, that's very, very important what suture you use and how you stitch it and how you overlap it. You can connect the gracilis to it and lengthen the size of your graft. If you're using the semi-T and you have a short thing, a lot of times you have a short graft, so you can use attach a gracilis to it and lengthen the graft.
Atik, you always use this technique or do you choose this patient? Number two, Have you tried the double bundle for especially PCL proximally on the femoral side?
I always use this technique for passing my graft, even if I have to use it as a normal PCL with a regular tunnel, because I find it easier to pass my graft. I have just done three cases of double bundle PCL where the double bundle is more in the femur. And of course, we all know we use a single tunnel because the area of the tibial attachment of the PCL is not very big. So I use a single tunnel there, use a double tunnel there. You can use that. You have to use two adjustable loops in the femur and you can use that. I used it for two, three patients of mine who were wrestlers who came in from where I work. I used it in that, but I did not find any advantage. And we all know there are enough studies now which say that there's not very great advantage.
I think you made two great points. One is the fixation is actually at the aperture and not beyond. So the second point, which I think really needs to be emphasized, is the location of the PCL attachment on the femur as opposed to the ligament of Humphrey. I think that those are two critical points, and I think you emphasized that. And I think that must be sort of driven home because the tendency is to put it along beyond the medial side. So I think that makes a great point that it has to be, it is way up in the intercontinental notch. So two great points. Okay, coming back to you, Ranjit. Now, if you had a patient with a polyligamentous injuries, ACL, PCL, and your MCL, what would be your sequence of reconstruction. Would you have, do you have a defined algorithm? How do you go with it?
Yeah, I'll first, if I am going with this internal brace concept, I'll go with PCL and MCL first, and then I'll do the ACL later on. If it is PCL, ACL, and MCL. If it is PCL, LCL, ACL, MCL, I'll go in a sequential manner. First is PCL, then LCL, then ACL, and last MCL.
So what are your specific indications for your internal bracing? Would you do that for all acute injuries? Do you do that for polyligamentous injuries? What is your preferred? What is your number one choice for internal bracing?
Now the grade one, we all know we are going with conservative treatment. Grade three, most of the surgeons, they do surgery. Now grade two is the gray zone. Now suppose I am having my ACL injured and I am planning for the ACL repair, definitely I'll go with the internal bracing for the MCL. Suppose I am having grade two injury of the MCL, and I suspect the patient is a athlete and will have a laxity later on, then I will go with MCL repair with internal bracing and simultaneously ACL reconstruction. So in those conditions, I'll go for the internal bracing.
Okay. Okay. One question, which is probably not a little outside the purview of the three presentations that have happened. Just like to quickly go around the panel, because I think it's a fascinating subject. So let me start with you, David. You have 30 plus years of experience, and you know we value your opinion on this. What is your take on the ALL, the anterolateral ligament? I mean, do you believe A, it exists, it should be repaired routinely, occasionally, selectively? What's your take on the ALL?
Selectively, we take care of selectively in a redo. Failure recurrence redo ACL reconstruction. Okay. When pivot is more than grade three, sometimes right. Obese patients and very contact athletes like wrestlers and all that. And I think the definite indication for ALL.
Right, right. Vivek, what's your take on this ALL?
All revisions should be taken care, ALL should be taken care of. And the people who are going to use the knees, the obese people and the wrestlers, their ALL should be done if the pivot shift is grossly positive.
So would you, if I'm understanding you correctly, what you're saying is high demand patients, yes. High demand athletes, ALL is mandatory. Is that
and
what you're saying?
Revision, and a revision.
And revisions, of course, yeah. Vivek, any other slant to this? Okay, Atik, any other?
Yes, I have a certain set of indications for doing my ALL. One is revision patients, definitely. Obese patients, high demand athletes, females, especially female athletes, and patients with hyperextension. These are my indications where I would do an ALL, irrespective of whether it's a primary or a revision. Because the failure rates are much higher in these. Now, the only thing is whether I would do an ALL on extra-articular. That is where it matters. ALL is a very precise surgery. You cannot go wrong with your attachment points with the ALL. Whereas the LET, the Lemaire's LET, is a little forgiving. So if you are a little way off also in your attachment, I think it works as well, and there have been enough papers to show that. But all these indications for me have some kind of importance, and I do an extra-articular, whether it's ALL or a LET, I do that.
Ranjit, if you can give me your comments, yeah. And then give you my take on the ALL.
Yeah, I totally agree with Dr. Atik. What we require is to protect your graft from the rotational stress. Now, in the revision situation, in the high-demand athletes, in hyperlax individuals. So in all these situations, we want to protect our graft or reconstructed ACL to be protected. So we should do ALL on these individuals. It should not be done routinely. If I am getting a second fracture, if I have not repaired it earlier, then I'll go and do the ALL later on.
Right, I think.
No one mentioned grade 3 pivot.
Grade 3 pivot, grade three closer pivot, pivot, yeah. Of course.
Yeah,
that is important.
I would agree. I think any patient is high demand, whether it's primary or revision procedures. I think ALL reconstruction is an excellent option. And I also agree of doing it. In fact, I remember when we started way back, we were not doing these intra-articular procedures for ACL. We were largely doing extra-articulars. I think somewhere we were actually reconstructing the anterolateral ligament. That gave tremendous stability to a lot of our high-demand athletes, some of whom were national level and international level wrestlers. So I think the point is that with high demand, and particularly patients with lax knees, hyperlax knees, hyperextension knees, these are all, and of course for all revisions, like all the four panelists have discussed, I think it's a great option, and it really must be explored and executed. Are there any other points, any other burning questions or points that any of the panelists want to bring up?
Yeah, Dr. Atik.
Yeah.
When you have taken a graft which is short and you are planning for a remnant preservation, because in remnant preservation you have to come down for your tibial exit point.
Yes.
Otherwise, you cannot preserve your remnant.
Exactly.
So in those cases, you sacrifice your PCL and do if the graft is, your graft link is short, or any other tips you can.
See, whenever you're doing a remnant preservation, like you rightly said, you have to go a little lower than what the actual insertion point is. It is safer to err on the lower side. If your graft is really short, then you have to be careful. See, your tibia cannot change. Remember that. If you're going lower, that means you'll probably compromise on the femur side. Right? So you have to, if you're preserving the remnant, you have to go down. Like I showed you in my video, you have to go a little lower, maybe 3 or 4, 5 millimeters lower than the attachment. So you will be able to preserve it. You have to visualize it nicely. So that's where I would probably, see, this comes with experience when you do adolescent or pediatric children. This is one place where I always recommend a safety incision in children or in adolescents, because you cannot go at the attachment side, because you'll end up damaging the physis. So you have to go lower, you compromise. So that's how you go lower, and then you compensate for the graft and the femur side.
Okay.
Ashok, internal bracing, can I ask?
Yeah, absolutely.
Ranjit and...
Sir.
Is there any long-term study at all? And what really happens to this after a couple of years? And is there any stress shielding which prevents it from healing? Any ideas in that?
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you are.
Sir, internal bracing is a new concept, and it is being used for last few years, and there is no long-term study as such, and it is being used for not only for MCL but for this Achilles tendon allograft, your lateral ligament in the ankle and in the elbow. So wherever you want to protect or repair, we use this internal bracing. And so this internal bracing, it gives you the length, it gives you the protection till your repair is successful. If your repair is not successful, what it is going to give in the long term, the studies, they haven't come up with that.
This is really just a scaffold that holds it in place while the healing is actually occurring. Yeah. I think that is the real thing. And you're right, there are no long-term outcome data on this particular technique as yet.
See, the concept of internal bracing came out when they started doing, they came back to, I would rather say, doing ACL repairs.
Yes.
So that's where the concept started. It acted like, it used to act like a secondary stabilizer till ligamentization and healing of the repaired ACL happened. So it was more like, it's something like a seat belt. It protects you, yet it's actually not causing. So when you do an internal bracing, you're never doing it in the same, you're leaving it a little loose. So it protects you at the time, till the time your healing and ligamentization happens to the graft or to the repaired ligament. But long-term studies of this is not there. But yes, there are studies as far as the tape that you are using. It's almost been, I think, 6 years since they've been using, and not like the old tapes where there was a lot of debris and things like that. They've not found that. So.
Right. I believe we have exceeded our time, and we are coming to the end of this webinar. So, any concluding remarks, David?
That all inside is a good concept, and it's good with some hands, but eventually you'll have to stick to what is good in your hands, and that's what I think. And if you are good at all inside, carry on, and do it. The MCL, internal bracing concept is something which has to be seen in the long run, what really happens. Because when we were young, we saw a lot of this artificial Teflon and all kinds of graft and
Gore-Tex ligaments.
The elite Kyo, the black ligament and all that. And it used to be a lot of horror stories. So I don't
David,
know.
Don't give your age. Don't give. Let's not give our ages away. Those are archaic now. A lot of the guys laugh at that.
Okay, yeah. you can conclude, Ashok.
Yeah. So I think that's a great point. I think just because it's a new technique does not need to be embraced. I think we should wait, do it selectively, and certainly in terms of the PCL, all inside has its very definite merits. The ACL also seems to have its merits, but there are no real long-term data that shows any distinct advantages apart from the safety and bone preservation. And I think, like David, words of wisdom, do something that works for you as long as it's beneficial to your patients. Recognize your own capabilities, and if a particular technique works in your hands, nothing like it, that's wonderful. So on that note, let me... Atik, Vivek, and Ranjit for 3 excellent presentations. Thank you, David, for helping moderate the session and all the questions and all the deliberations that we've had between all of us. And we hope that all the participants have enjoyed this, and we hope there have been some takeaways from this webinar. Lastly, I'd like to thank Ortho TV for setting up this whole exercise. Thank you all, and stay safe. Have a great weekend.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ashok. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
Good talk from all three of you guys. And thanks to all.